Grace Bible Church Pearlside Online. The heroes of our time did not become great by simply living an easy life. I have a dream. Pastor Billy Lau uncovers God's purpose behind life's tests of faith in his message, Faith at Work, From Injustice to Honor. Part 5 of our series, Prevailing Faith, Living at the Next Level.
How many of us know that faith is one of those topics that we can't talk about enough? Because it's essential in the Christian life. I mean, it's what Christianity is all about. It's trusting in a God that we can't see and believing in his promises that are written in his word. And so, you know, as we continue on in this series, our prayer is that your faith will grow. Because as we know, and as we sung about this morning, you know, in life we're going to face storms and trials and walk out into the deep. And it's there, if we trust in God, we'll experience him at a whole new level. And so, you know, this verse here in your notes says this: and without faith, it is impossible to please God. Without faith, it's impossible to please God, because anyone who comes to him must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who earnestly seek him. So without faith, it's impossible to please God. Then we need to learn a little bit more about what faith is and how we walk out faith in this life. And I think all of us are aware that, you know, when things are easy, faith is easy. Isn't that true? When things are going good, it's easy to trust God. It's easy to believe God for good things. But it's when things are hard, that's when faith really becomes faith. Yeah, that's when faith really is tested and becomes real in our lives. And unfortunately, we all realize that in life, we are going to face trials and injustice and pain. You know, yesterday, I took my family out to Ka'ahava, which is on the northeast side of the island. Anybody live in Ka'ahava? You have a lot of faith driving all the way out here from there. You know, it's about an hour drive. One of our friends rented a beach house out there. And so we were looking forward to a whole day at the beach. We're going to snorkel. We're going to swim. It's going to be great. So we drive an hour, get all the way out there, get into the water, and finally in the water. You know, okole all sore from driving. We finally get in the water. And after no more than 10 minutes in the water, I kid you not, the only Portuguese man of war in all of Ka'ahava decides to wrap itself around the arm of my six-year-old son. Yes, and I mean wrap itself around. There you go. That's his battle scars. That's not Sanskrit on its arm. That is a Portuguese man of war writing. And so, of course, you know, if you've ever been stung by a jellyfish, you know how painful that can be. And so, you know, I grab him, pull him out of the ocean. Now I'm trying to unwrap him. I mean, literally unwrap him with this thing. So it's stinging me. And the whole time I'm thinking, are you serious? You know what I mean? We're looking forward to a nice day at the beach, and we just get here, and it's turned into trauma. You know what I'm saying? So we're unwrapping him. I'm getting stung, and finally got him. You know, he's screaming bloody murder. So, of course, you know, I poured a little pee on it. You know, you got to do what you got to do. And he didn't know it was pee at first. I put it in a cup. You don't need to know all that. But I told you anyway. And, you know, and he's screaming. And finally, as he starts calming down, I'm just thinking the whole time, man, isn't this just like life? You know, you're expecting a nice day at the beach, metaphorically. Things are going to be great. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, out of left field, circumstances and storms come in, and they just throw you for a loop. Anybody ever been there? Yeah? I mean, not necessarily the jellyfish and the pea, but you know what I mean? In life, storms just come out of nowhere. And it's in those moments that our faith is really tested. Because I had a thought going through my mind. Out of all the kids in this ocean, that jellyfish had to attack my kid. The one that's had skin problems for the last 3 years. The one that's gone through all the trauma that he's gone through. And then I'm thinking, man, I don't know if he's allergic to jellyfish. So checking his breathing. Anyway, he was fine. But, you know, so as he started getting better, I told him, don't worry, Micah, we got the jellyfish. You can have your revenge afterwards. And, you know, trying to take his mind off of it, I'm trying to think of ways to get back at the jellyfish. But anyway, but the point was, I thought about this, that just out of nowhere, storms come. Isn't that true? Out of nowhere, trials can come. And sometimes we can get into a victim mentality in life, yeah? Why does this always happen to me? Why is it always my kid that's the one that's getting hurt? Why is it always me? Why not sting that guy? You know what I'm saying? He looks like he deserves it a little more, you know? Right? I mean, come on, you've thought that. You know, why me, right? And we can easily get into a victim mentality. But if we realize that God is with us, that even though pain may exist for a little while, yeah, in Christ, we know that we will have the victory in the end. And that's the perspective we have to have. That's what faith is. And so as Micah started getting better, I handed him a butter knife, and he got to exact his revenge on the jellyfish there. There he is. And I wanted to make that a teaching moment for the jellyfish, a teaching moment for my son that, hey, look, listen, son, in life you're going to have pain, okay? In life you're going to have trials. In life you're going to have suffering. But in the end, we will win. In the end, Jesus Christ promises that we have the victory in him. And that's the perspective we all have to have in life, because the jellyfish of life, the storms of life are going to come. And if we don't have a perspective of faith that in Christ we have victory, we can easily become victims and live a life of victim mentality rather than victory mentality. And as we get into the message this morning, there was no one in the Bible that could have had a victim mentality than the man by the name of Joseph. Joseph, if you know the story, and if you don't, I'll tell you about it. Joseph was the favorite son of his father, Jacob, and that brought the displeasure of all of his brothers. And so the brothers plotted to have Joseph killed. They said, we're going to kill him because, you know, we don't like this kid. He's arrogant. Dad loves him best. So we're going to kill him. How many of you ever had brothers like that? Don't raise your hand, right? And so in a moment of mercy, they said, you know what? Let's not kill him. Let's sell him as a slave. Yeah, these good guys, yeah. And we're not going to kill him. We're going to sell him out as a slave. And so they sell Joseph as a slave to a band of Ishmaelites who take him to Egypt, where he becomes a servant in the house of a high-ranking Egyptian ruler by the name of Potiphar. And there Joseph lived, once the favorite son of his father, Jacob, now a slave in the house of an Egyptian taskmaster. And if anyone had a moment where he could have said, you know what, this isn't fair. God told me I was supposed to be a ruler. God told me that great things are going to happen to me. What am I doing? First of all, he was thrown in a pit. What am I doing in a pit? And now what am I doing as a slave? And sometimes in life we feel like that. And Joseph could have easily felt like, I'm a victim. God, you've abandoned me. God, where are you? I'm going to turn my back on you. But as we know from the story, and we'll see, that's not what Joseph does. He doesn't turn his back on God. He rather turns to God. And so how do we bounce back in the midst of trials and injustice, in the midst of the storms? How do we have faith? It's in your notes there. Live close to him and let him live through you. Live close to God and let God live through you. Genesis 39 says this, the Lord was with Joseph and he became a successful man and he was in the house of his Egyptian master. His master saw that the Lord was with him, and that the Lord caused all that he did to succeed in his hand. So Joseph found favor in his sight and attended him. And he made him overseer of his house and put him in charge of all that he had. From the time that he made him overseer in his house and over all he had, the Lord blessed the Egyptian's house for Joseph's sake. The blessing of the Lord was on all that he had in house and in field. So he left all that he had in Joseph's charge. Now this is really remarkable if you think about it. This Egyptian put Joseph in charge of his entire household, put him in charge of everything that he owned. This Hebrew slave is now put in charge. Why? The Bible tells us because the Lord is with Joseph. And you know what that implies? It implies that Joseph stayed close to the Lord. See, when things go bad in our lives, don't most of us want to run away from God? We kind of get angry at him. We get frustrated with him. We say, you know what, God, if you're going to abandon me, fine, I don't need you anyway. Or we get bitter with God, but that's not what Joseph did. He ran close to God. He honored him all the more, even in the midst of his trial. And I want to submit to you this morning that that is the key to our success in life, that we would get through the trials of life by remaining close to the Lord. It's funny to me. I've been in ministry for a while and working with young people and all that. But, you know, when bad things happen, we tend to want to run away from God. We tend to want to run from him, when the reality is when the storms hit, that's when we should run to God. Yeah. When the storms come, we don't run out into the storm. We should run to shelter. And God is our shelter. He is the one that we should run to. So I don't know where you're at this morning in your life. If you're facing storms and trials, and the devil will want to make you run or run away, we need to run to him instead. Can I hear an amen to that? And that's what Joseph did. He ran to God, and he stayed faithful to God, even in the midst of the storm that he was facing. Even when it seemed like nothing good was happening on the outside, even when it seemed like God was doing nothing for him on the outside, he stayed close to God, and he stayed faithful. That's where faith kicks in. You know, one of my favorite illustrations when it comes to faith is the story of Chinese bamboo. Anybody grow Chinese bamboo? Chinese bamboo is one of the tallest breeds of bamboo in the world, and it grows up to heights of 80 to 90 feet. But when you plant it, I'm told, or I've read, that it takes 5 years from the time it's planted till it to actually start growing above the ground. So you'll plant this bamboo plant in the ground, and it'll take 5 years before you see anything happen above the surface. Now, I don't know about you. I'm not a gardener. I'm too impatient for that. I think I would get frustrated of coming out every day, watering my little dirt pile and seeing nothing happen month after month, year after year, just watering that thing faithfully, giving it whatever bamboo needs, being faithful to fertilize that thing and seeing nothing happen. I don't know if I could live like that for 5 years. But after 5 years, they say that it begins to grow to a height of 80 to 90 feet within a span of 5 to 6 weeks. Yes, ma'am. In the span of 5 to 6 weeks, the bamboo plant now grows to a height of 80 to 90 feet. Now, the question begs itself, how long did it take to grow to that height? Was it 5 to 6 weeks, or was it 5 years and 6 weeks? You see, what we often don't realize below the surface of our lives, God is doing something. Even though we can't see it, even though we can't tell that anything good is happening, something is happening below the surface that is paving the way and preparing the way for what God wants to do in our lives above the surface. But see, if we just look at our circumstances, sometimes we don't see anything happening. And we're tempted to say, you know what, never mind, this is stupid. I don't want to do this anymore. I'm wasting my life. I'm wasting my time. When nothing good is happening, when all the while God is trying to do something below the surface in our lives, which will support the weight and the height that God wants to bring above the surface. See, all too often, we're more concerned about what's happening above the surface in our circumstances, when in reality, God's more concerned about what's happening below the surface in our character and in our lives. And when nothing seems to be happening above the surface, God is trying to form something below the surface. And so we see Joseph here, our poor friend Joseph, thrown in a pit by his brothers, now sold into slavery, but he stays faithful in what God is forming inside of him through his faith and obedience and trust in God is going to support the victory that he wants to bring us later on in life. And the hard thing is, you know, we don't like to wait as God works below the surface. Isn't that true? We don't like to wait for God. We want it to happen now. And if you think about it, we're a really impatient generation. Isn't that true? We've learned to be very impatient. It's kind of funny. I took my kids out one time, and we were standing in a line behind this other kid who was just getting all mad at his cell phone. He said, I don't have LTE anymore. It's stuck on 3G. It's taking so long to load. And I started thinking to myself, kids nowadays have no idea how hard it was back in our day. You guys remember this AOL screen? How many of you remember America Online? Any of you guys remember AOL? It's not there. But you remember AOL? You have to first connect it to your telephone line, right? And then you click that button, and then what happens? You hear your dial tone, boo, right? Do, 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 right? And then you're waiting. You're like, come on, anytime now. And go ahead and throw it up, go ahead and throw it up. And then we see this picture here of this guy, right? And you're like, when is this guy gonna get to the next square? You know what I'm saying? Like, hurry up and get to the next square. And you're sitting there going, any moment now, I'm gonna get to check my email. But no. And then your grandma picks up the phone, right? Goodbye. You're like, I waited so long and then it didn't work. So you dial it again, and then you finally get online. Welcome, you've got mail, right? And you're blazing on the internet at 56K. Yeah? If you don't know what 56K is, it's 6 times slower than 3G, which is like 60 times slower than LTE on your phone now. Anyway, you don't need to know that. But the point is, you know, we've learned that to be impatient. Just in life, it's just things don't move fast enough for us, especially if you're younger. You're so used to having things immediately. But the reality is God doesn't work that way. God doesn't work like LTE all the time. Sometimes he does, and I love it when he does. But more often than not, he's trying to build something inside of us while we wait. Think about Joseph. It would be another 20-something years before he finally has the fulfillment of the prophetic word over his life. Ever had to wait for something for 20 years? And trust God for 20 years, it would be 13 years from the time Joseph gets thrown into prison until he becomes the ruler in Egypt. Ever had to wait 13 years being in prison, seemingly, metaphorically, while you're waiting for God to show up? But it's in those moments that faith is being birthed in our heart. Can I hear an amen to that? It's in those moments of waiting that God is building something below the surface that will support the weight of what God wants to do in our lives above the surface. So how are we to be faithful while we are waiting? Well, you and I have the benefit of being able to look back at history and seeing how faithful God has been throughout history. You and I are living on the other side of the cross, where we can look back and see how God sent his son Jesus to suffer the greatest injustice in the world, to die the death that we should have died on that cross, and that we have the ability of looking back in time and seeing how God raised Jesus from the dead, proving that he is faithful. So when you and I have to wait for God to show up, we can look to the cross and we can look to the gospel and see that God has been good to us when we didn't deserve it. How much more will he not be good to us now and provide for us now? Even if we have to wait, we know that God will one day come through. We know that we will have the victory. Look what the Bible says here in Romans chapter 5. But God demonstrates his own love for us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to him through the death of his son, how much more, say much more, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? If God sent Jesus to the cross while we were yet sinners, how much more will he not provide for us and lead us into victory now that you and I trust in him? And if you're here this morning and you're not yet a Christian, the victory in life comes through Jesus Christ. Storms are going to come to the righteous and the unrighteous, the Bible says, but victory comes only through God. You're going to have storms, you're going to have trials, but when we have Jesus in our lives, we know that we have the victory. And so Joseph now finds himself in this place where he is ruling over Potiphar's household. I mean, that's incredible. How does that happen? How does it happen? It only happens because God honored him. God provided for him. God prospered him. In your season of trial, in your season of waiting, are you staying close to God, or are you tempted to turn and run? Are you tempted to just kind of, I'm just going to get through life, and I'm not going to pay attention to God. I'm not going to stay close to him. Victory comes as we stay close to him. Now watch this. Even while Joseph was faithful, he's going to now face yet another storm. Joseph kept his eyes on God, but what ended up happening was he was so prosperous, he was so successful that he caught the eye of his master Potiphar's wife. And Potiphar's wife now falsely accuses him of rape because she can't have him. And now he gets thrown into prison a second time. He gets thrown into prison a second time because of being falsely accused of rape. Now watch this, Genesis 39. Joseph's master took him and put him in prison, the place where the king's prisoners were confined. This is like the highest security prison. But watch this. He had an opportunity to be bitter, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you be bitter? But while Joseph was there in the prison, their Lord was with him and showed him kindness and granted him favor in the eyes of the prison warden. So the warden put Joseph in charge of all those held in prison, and he was made responsible for all that was done there. The warden paid no attention to anything under Joseph's care because the Lord was with Joseph and gave him success in whatever he did. See, Joseph didn't let this another round of injustice now cause him to be bitter and run from God. He stayed faithful to God even while facing yet another injustice. I mean, that's real faith, isn't it? And so in your notes there, it says, resolve to be bitter, to be better, not bitter, and to serve God with honor. How do we endure the trials that come? How do we stay faithful? Resolve by resolving to be better through the trial, not bitter, and to continue to serve God with honor. See, not only did Joseph keep his faith in God in the midst of these unjust circumstances, he also put his faith to work in the way he served even his ungodly rulers. Now, how many of you ever worked for a boss that you just kind of felt like, this guy doesn't deserve my best, or this girl, right? I mean, we don't always all love our boss, you know. I love my boss because, you know, it's Pastor Norman. But anyway, and he's here somewhere, so I have to say that. No, I'm just kidding. And he's my father-in-law, so I got to say that twice. Anyway, but you know, we always have these moments where, like, I don't want to serve this guy. He doesn't deserve my hard work. He doesn't deserve my sacrifice. I'll work hard and I'll pour out for a person who deserves it. Well, if you look at Joseph and his journey of faith, he served even ungodly rulers and ungodly leaders. He served his master Potiphar so well that he raised him up. And now he's serving the prison warden. Instead of getting bitter, he gets better. And he gives his best even in the midst of unjust circumstances. And look what God does. God elevates him. God raises him up. How are we when we face circumstances that are unjust? How do we serve people that we feel don't deserve it? Look at what the Bible says here. It says, slaves, obey your earthly masters. And the word slave doesn't just mean, you know, slaves, but it's also indentured servitude. It says, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear and with sincerity of heart, just as, watch this now, you would obey Christ. Wait, you mean I gotta serve that guy the way that I serve Jesus? I need to serve that person who doesn't deserve it with the same heart that I would serve the Lord with? Absolutely. Watch this. It continues. Obey them, not only to win their favor when their eye is on you, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from your heart. So you mean I have to serve this ungodly person from my heart, not just looking good on the outside? Serve wholeheartedly, it goes on, as if you were serving the Lord and not people. As if you were serving the Lord and not people, because you know that the Lord will reward each one for whatever good they do. And this is what Joseph did. In the midst of his unjust circumstances, he served his unjust captors, his unjust rulers, as if he was serving the Lord, and the Lord prospered him, and the Lord honored him, and the Lord blessed him. I wonder how many of us are missing the doors that God wants to open in our lives because we're choosing not to serve wholeheartedly because we don't like the person that we're working with, or the person that we're working for. And so God is not being honored in that moment, and there's no opportunity for us to be elevated. One of our young adults, or she's a young mom now, Dwayne Yanagita, married to Travis Yanagita, she's a student in our Every Nation Leadership Institute, started working at a dental office several years ago. And when she first got there, she tells me that she noticed that, man, there was just all kinds of tension in the workplace. Anybody ever experienced tension in the workplace? All kinds of tension, and the bosses, the doctors didn't treat the employees well, and as a result, the employees disrespected the bosses, and there was just so much tension and disunity in the dental office. And so when Dwayne got there, she decided, you know, I'm going to start praying for my workplace. And so she would pray for her coworkers, pray for the doctors who were mean to them, and even when she was being treated with disrespect, she decided to honor and respect the doctors that were treating her badly. And as a result, things began to happen in the workplace. I just want to read some of it to you. This is what she wrote to me. As a result, the doctor's heart changed and began treating everyone better. He even thanked me and credited me for improving the wellness, these are his words, the wellness of the office, and even for himself. This moment opened the door for me to share my faith with the doctor whom everyone hated. The doctor then began allowing me to pray for people in the office, including the patients. He even gave me the opportunity to take a leave of absence so I could attend ENLI and held my position so that I could return later if I wanted to. As a result, Dwayne's witness in the workplace resulted in 5 of her coworkers coming to Christ and got them all connected into a grace group and was able to raise one of them up as a leader and is turning over the group to one of her coworkers in the near future. Now, I mean, I don't know about you, but that's affecting the environment of a workplace. One person being a Joseph in the midst of unjust circumstances, not bowing down to what everyone else is doing, returning hate for hate and, you know, injustice for injustice, but rather saying, I'm going to be a light. I'm going to be a Joseph in the midst of my prison. And the result was hearts were changed, lives were changed, destinies and families were affected because one person. And she's a normal person. She'll tell you this herself. She's not spectacular in any means, but she just decided, I'm going to be a light in my darkness. I'm going to bloom where I'm planted. If you plant me here, God, then I'm going to bloom here. Joseph, if you're going to plant me in a prison, then I'm going to bloom in this prison. Are you blooming where you're planted? Because I think what God does is he places us in circumstances and situations to bring us into proximity with the very people that he wants to reach. But if we give way to the bitterness and we give way to the injustice and we feel like a victim, then we don't rise up and be the light for Christ that he wants us to be in the midst of the circumstances and storms. And when Dwayne first shared this story with me, I was like, damn, that's amazing. I don't know that I would do that. If someone's treating me unjustly, I might just treat them bad too, right? Isn't that true? But here we see Dwayne putting on the very spirit of Christ, the same spirit that Joseph walked with, and she's blooming. And God has done an amazing thing there through her life. How can God use you to put your faith to work wherever you are, whether it's in your home, if you're a student on your campus, at your job? If we allow God to work and don't allow the enemy to bring us into a victim mentality, God can use us. Why don't you throw that picture up one more time of the way I didn't point her out. She's the one, not me, the picture. That one. There you go. She's the one right there. That's the way. And she was able to impact and affect her whole office because she decided, I'm going to be a light for God. And I want to say, you are where you are because God wants to use you there. Can I hear an amen to that? And that means we have to respect and honor and serve wholeheartedly as if we are serving Christ. And I wonder what God would do in our communities. I wonder what God would do in our world if Christians all over the place decided, I'm going to be a Joseph in the midst of injustice and not let myself become bitter, but I'm going to become better and I'm going to rise up. See, this is the way we put our faith at work. One more example, another young lady in our Every Nation Leadership Institute is a young lady by the name of Jen Gibb. And Jen is in her mid-20s, and some of you may have heard her testimony. You can go ahead and put that up. Some of you may have heard her testimony before, but Jen is in her mid-20s, found out she has kidney failure. That's Jen, the one on the left. Kidney failure at the age of, in her early 20s. Now, I don't know about you, but I would kind of get a little upset with God, yeah? How come I'm going through this right now? I'm a good person. I try to serve you, and now I'm going through kidney failure. But Jen, rather than allowing herself to become a victim or to get bitter, she's allowed herself to get better. And she's been serving God, reaching out, and she decided while she's waiting for a kidney transplant to leave her job as a nurse because she felt God calling her into ministry, to come to our school of ministry. not knowing how she was going to get medical insurance. And we tried to talk her out of it. We were like, look, Jen, you got to take care of your health. You know, don't leave your job. You need that medical coverage and all that kind of thing. But she said, no, I know God has called me to do this, and I know he's going to provide for me. So she leaves her job, and by miraculous circumstances, which I don't have time to explain, she has full medical coverage while she's been in our school. Full medical coverage. She just pays a small copay, and God's providing for her. And so she's waiting for her kidney transplant. Now, that's amazing, right? But then she decides, I feel like God wants me to go to UNLV on our short-term student mission trip. So she joins the mission team, gets ready to go on the mission trip, but she needs dialysis every single night. She's on dialysis every single night. So she has all of her dialysis equipment sent up to Vegas before her so that every night when she comes back from the campus, she can do her kidney dialysis in Las Vegas because she knows that God's called her to be on mission up there. Now that's a young girl who's saying, I'm not going to get bitter, I'm going to get better. I'm not going to let the circumstances and storms of life stop me from serving God and being faithful to God. I'm going to keep on going, and she's been tremendously fruitful on the campus. I had the privilege of meeting the people that she's reaching out to, and I'm just going, oh my God, Jen, you're amazing. Like I said, I don't know about, if I was her, I might just feel a little self-pity and say, you know what, I deserve to stay home. I deserve to not have to put out and to serve and to give. I need to be served rather than serve others. But Jen said, no, I'm going to be a Joseph. And I'm going to give my best even while I wait for God to come through. See, a lot of us, we'll give our best to God after God comes through miraculously, yeah? Yeah, when God comes through, then I'll go all out for God. I think it's the exact opposite. The Bible tells us even in the midst of difficulty, even in the midst of storms, we give our best and we go out wholeheartedly. And God gets the glory in the process. And so I look at these two stories, Jen and Dwayne's story, and I think, man, you know what? If God can use them, God can surely use me. Even while I wait for God to come through. Surely God can use all of us. Can I hear an amen to that? See, how we serve in the midst of our trials, how we work in the midst of the community while we wait for God to answer our prayers is really what reveals our faith. Because stuff is happening below the surface while we wait. So faithfully, we're called to not just serve, but faithfully trust God's process and God's timing. Because we know that God's going to come through. He's a good God. And maybe it's not the way that I think, or the way that I'd like him to, but we know in faith that he's gonna come through as we faithfully trust him and his timing. So we last left Joseph in prison now the second time, unjustly accused of rape. And what does Joseph do? He blooms where he's planted. He says, I'm gonna keep on serving, I'm gonna be faithful. And it was in the prison now, this is where he meets two men, the cupbearer of the king and the baker. And both of these men receive prophetic dreams. And guess what? God gave Joseph the ability to interpret these dreams. So he interprets their dreams, interprets them right. The cupbearer gets restored to his position of authority. And this is what Joseph tells him. He says, when you get restored to your place of authority, because God told me you would, don't forget me. Put in a good word for me, because I don't deserve to be here. Well, how many of us know that the reality is Joseph didn't get pulled out of the prison right after that? It would be 2 more years that he'd have to wait and serve faithfully in that prison before God comes through. You know, I just think that's how God is sometimes. Because if he operated the way that we would want him to operate, we wouldn't learn to have to trust, to have to wait. We wouldn't learn the faith that is developed as we're trusting him when it's hard and unjust. He had to wait 2 more years. And it's after 2 years, finally, Pharaoh has a dream. And the cupbearer goes, oh, I forgot. There's this dude, Joseph, in the prison. I forgot about him. He interprets dreams. And so Pharaoh calls for Joseph here in Genesis 41. So Pharaoh sent for Joseph, and he was quickly brought from the dungeon. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before Pharaoh. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream. No one can interpret it, but I have heard it said of you, 2 years later, by the way, that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, Joseph said, replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he deserves. Now, let's take a look at the screen and at what it might have looked like long ago when Pharaoh brings Joseph up out of the prison. Check this out.
It would call for a man of exceptional talent. That excludes each of you. Potiphar, perhaps. The answer is obvious. There could be no better man for this job. than this man himself. Can we find anyone endowed with the spirit of God as he is? Now, hear the word of Pharaoh, Ra on earth, God as man. You shall be my chancellor. And all my people shall respect your orders. Only this throne shall set me above you. I make you the governor of all of Egypt. I set you over my house, my people, my entire kingdom. Without your consent, no man shall lift up hand or foot in all of Egypt.
It would be now 13 years after Joseph is sold into slavery that he finds himself now, finally, out of prisons, out of dungeons, and exalted to the highest place in all of Egypt. 13 years. He had to trust in God. 13 years, he had to keep on looking to God and saying, I know you're going to come through. I know you're faithful. And while I wait, I'm going to remain faithful. I'm going to serve you. I'm going to stay close to you. I'm going to be a blessing to others. I'm going to bloom where I've been planted. For 13 years, he did this day in and day out. Now, I know that he probably had his moments of frustration and his moments of, God, why is this happening to me? But he kept on being faithful. And the Lord proved himself faithful in return. See, promotion, the Bible tells us, comes from God. But God, again, is more interested in what's happening below the surface in our lives than what's happening above the surface. Because what if God didn't do all the forming in those years in the prison? Maybe Joseph gets to the highest level of authority, and then he forgets God there. And maybe he gets to the highest levels of power, and there he abandons God, and there even worse things happen. But God said, I'm going to shape you and form you for the destiny that I have for you. And maybe that's where some of us are this morning. We're yet waiting for God to come through. Maybe it hasn't been 13 years. Maybe it's been 13 months. Maybe it's been 20 years while you've been waiting for God to come through in some area. I think we can take a page out of Joseph's story and say, all right, God, I'm going to remain close to you. I'm going to stay faithful to you because I trust you. I'm going to serve you as faithfully as I can where I am. I'm going to serve even the unjust leaders and unjust rulers that I have, take the opportunities I have to share the gospel with them and be a light. And I trust you for the results. I trust you that you are going to come through for me. See, that's where faith is tested. It's not just faith for the easy things. It's the hard stuff of life. Years while we're waiting for God to come through. Can we trust him? And as we do, he gets the glory in the end. See, vindication and promotion comes from God. It comes from God. When we are faithful, God goes, all right, I see that. I see your faithfulness, and I see that I can trust you and reward you and bring you out. Look at what Psalm 75 says. No one from the east or the west, or from the desert can exalt themselves. It is God who judges. He brings one down and he exalts another. Many of us here are probably waiting for God to exalt us. When am I gonna have my moment? When am I gonna get out of this prison, metaphorically speaking, in life? When am I gonna have my breakthrough? When am I gonna have this answer to prayer? And it's in the waiting that God works. You know, most of you know our story for the last 3 years from 2012 really to the beginning of 2015. It was like being in prison for our family. Our son Micah, the one that got stung by the jellyfish, he has really, really, really bad allergies, and as a result, he wasn't sleeping, and many of you have heard this story already. And it was just hell because he was always having an allergic reaction to something. We were rushing him to the ER several times and always constantly worried about him. He was bleeding all the time, and it was just bad. And I remember many times during that season of not getting any sleep, of the trials, of the anxiety and the fear, where I felt like God had abandoned us. I really did. And I had my moments of feeling like, God, this isn't fair. Man, I've been serving you since I was 16 years old, and this is what we get in return. I've been faithful to you. You kind of go through the list. I'm pretty sure there's no sin in my life. I'm pretty sure I've been faithful. This isn't fair, God. And I would look at other people's kids, and they're doing fine. We'd have to leave things early because he's having an attack and all these kinds of things. And I look at other people's kids and say, that's not fair. I know they don't serve the Lord. How come their kid's fine? You know what I'm saying? Come on, can I be honest with you? And it's hard in those moments to keep on looking at God, but let me tell you what got us through it. It was keeping our eyes on Jesus. I'm not even joking. is saying, God, I know that you love us. I know that you're faithful, and I know you're going to get us through this. I know that. And it was, and I'd have to tell myself that every single day. I'd have to preach it to my wife and my kid. And let me tell you, the hardest part was when Micah was five. It was about a year ago during the roughest season of it. I pray for him every single night. And I remember one day he said, Dad, why do you keep praying for me? Because it doesn't work. At 5 years old, he's having a crisis of faith. He said, because it doesn't work. You keep praying for me, and I keep getting worse. Let me tell you, that broke my heart. I was like, man, how do I explain to this kid, you know, be like Joseph, son, you know what I'm saying? Let me open the Bible to you and explain to you theologically why we can trust him. All he could, and this is what he said. And I said, son, God's going to get me. And he said, no, God's not good. He told me that. God's not good. And he said, because I can't eat pizza. That was his logic. He's allergic to gluten and he's allergic to dairy, very allergic to dairy. And so he'd see his friends eating pizza and he'd feel like, no, God doesn't love me. I mean, that's a five-year-old's logic, right? And it broke my heart. I remember I just leaned over to him and I realized, man, I need to share more about Jesus with this kid. I need to pray with him. And so I'd read him the kid's Bible every single night, show him how sin is the cause of evil, showing him how Jesus died on the cross for our sin, and one day we're going to be victorious in Christ. And, you know, little by little, his faith began to grow. And he stopped saying, God's not good. He started praying along with me. I taught him the Lord's Prayer, and we'd pray together every single night, and we'd pray together every single day. And here's the awesome thing. Just like God said he would, we received a prophetic word when he was 2 months old. Right before Micah turned six, he had dramatic breakthrough. Dramatic breakthrough. We don't know why. Well, I know why. It's because God did it. You know, there's no other reason. Out of nowhere, he just got better. And now he's doing phenomenal to the point where he can shake off a jellyfish like a boss. You know what I'm saying? Like, whatever, you know. Can't kill me. And it was just tremendous. And now he has so much faith. He has so much faith because he had to live 3 years in a prison suffering when no other kids were suffering around him. And now he has faith that God can come through. So yesterday when he got stung with a jellyfish, one of his friends came and prayed for him. And this is what he told my wife when she was putting him to bed last night. I think I got better because Stella prayed for me. He has so much faith now that God is coming through. And you know what? That's what God's more interested in. Yeah, we got to walk through seasons in the prison, but guess what? God's going to be with you in that prison. He was there with us. There's so many nights where I felt like, God, you've abandoned us. Where are we? 4 a.m, 3 a.m, and just, what do we do? There's no hope here. Doctors told us, you just got to hope he grows out of it. Well, thanks a lot. You know, that's not very helpful. But God was there, and he carried us through. Maybe you're in a prison right now. Stay close to him. He'll carry you through. He will. And when you get out of it, you'll see why God has brought you through that season. Joseph would have never even met the baker and the cupbearer had he not been in prison. He would have never made it to the place of being second in command in Egypt had he not been sold into slavery by his brothers. See, we don't see the whys and the hows of how God works, but here's what we can do. We can stay close to him. We can stay faithful. We can serve and bloom where we're planted, and we'll see the hand of God at work in the end. Amen. Can I pray for you as we come to a close? Maybe you're in a situation right now where you feel like you're in a prison and you feel like God's abandoned you. I want to tell you, God has not abandoned you. Scripture tells us that when we're in Christ, he will never leave nor forsake us. And so, Lord Jesus, I pray right now for every person here who feels abandoned by God, who feels forgotten in a prison of trials and circumstances. I pray right now that we would, like Joseph, stay close to you, draw close to you. And as we do, that we would find your favor even while in the prison. We would find your blessing in your hand guiding us and protecting us even while in the prison. And Lord, I pray that as we stay close to you, that we would serve faithfully in the midst of our prisons, that others would see your greatness and your love through our lives. And Lord, that when we get out one day, when you bring us through this, we'll have a testimony of faith that will encourage many. Because what we suffer through, others suffer through, and even worse. You're giving us a story that will be able to be a light to many. So Lord, we pray right now for your grace that we would draw close to you. In Jesus' name, amen.